Welcome to the Journal. Ever since last week's White House summit, it's been like one big game of political ping pong, with the president and Democratic and Republican leaders paddling health care talking points back and forth so fast the rest of us could hardly keep up. So for the moment, we're going to step away from that game, remove ourselves from the roar of partisan rhetoric, and remind ourselves of why this country needs health care reform in the first place. One day before that big summit last week, there was a hearing in Congress to find out why Anthem Blue Cross of California is raising premiums by as much as 39%, 15 times the rate of inflation.
Do you swear or affirm the testimony you're about to give to be the truth, the whole truth, nothing but truth in the matter pending before this committee?
Yeah, I do.
Angela Brawley, the CEO of WellPoint, the parent company of Anthem Blue Cross and Blue Shield, was called before a House subcommittee to explain the increase.
You know, you had to know this was going to be trouble. I mean, a 39% rate increase in this climate. You know what we've been doing up here the last year. You know what's happened down the White House tomorrow. You knew this was going to be trouble.
Yes.
So you knew the landscape into which you were entering, correct?
Correct.
Did you make a judgment as to whether or not this was the best time to do this?
It's a difficult situation, and even to break even, the rates would have been in the 20s. In terms of overall average, And we were concerned, which is why we also capped the rates at the top end of 39%, because we did not want rates for individuals to go in excess of that cap.
News of the increase was brazen and shocking enough on its own. But it turns out that in 2008, WellPoint paid 39 of its executives $1 million or more, and that over 2 years alone, the company spent more than $27 million for executive retreats at luxury resorts. Fresh ammunition for those who argue that health care costs wouldn't be skyrocketing if the insurance industry didn't put profit ahead of patients.
I mean, it'd be great if we could guarantee every business to have 2.5 to 5% profit, and heck, you're at 7% or more.
You know, actually, over the five-year period, our profit margin has declined. We continue to get more efficient as a company and as a business, and we are working hard to reduce healthcare costs and improve access to high-quality, affordable healthcare. So it is important to be a business that sustain that we have an appropriate profit, and we think a 4.8% margin on a relative basis is very efficient.
That's 4.8% of the $60+ billion in earnings WellPoint reported last year. In other words, nearly $3 billion of profit after taxes.
I don't mind you making a profit, but at the end of the year, 2009, a horrible year, you still made $2 billion, and that's not enough.
And we serve 34 million Americans across the country, and we feel that it is appropriate for our business to be sustained so that we can be there for those members when they incur those health care costs.
Anthem Blue Cross policyholders testified that with the big jump in premiums, their only options are to pay through the nose, switch to a cheaper policy with less protection, or drop their insurance completely.
I will have to hope that I don't get sick or injured. Hope is not an effective health care policy. And hope is not what Anthem is supposed to be selling. I eat right, I exercise, I take care of myself, I'm generally a healthy person, and I resent being squeezed in this way.
In this economically depressed environment, I find the act of Anthem Blue Cross raising premium costs to individual policyholders for such high amounts truly unconscionable. My current policy states that I must meet an annual $1,500 deductible for each two members of my family, which totals $3,000. And an annual out-of-pocket expense of $4,500 for each two members of my family, which totals $9,000, in addition to the yearly premium of $12,504 that I pay already.
Do you believe a company that can afford to pay a single executive nearly $10 million in 1 year has the right to demand higher premiums from you so that it can, quote, keep up with the market?
It makes me sick to think that all of this money is going to executives in this economy when so many people are struggling.
I, of course, too, think it's unconscionable, and I believe the number I read was that in the last quarter, WellPoint had a profit of over $4 billion. Even if you cut that in half, it's still an incredibly healthy profit, so it just speaks to as I said in my testimony, profiteering versus profit making. There is a difference, and profit making is fine. It drives our economy. It's the foundation of American business. But profiteering, when it affects people like us in the way that it has, is just wrong. It speaks to a lack of decency. And lack of decency may not be illegal, but it's wrong, and that's why I think it requires government intervention and regulation.
Well Point's Angela Brawley stayed on message. She was unapologetic about her company's profits. But what she heard back from the subcommittee was, shame on you.
I think that a 39% rate increase at a time when people, Americans, are losing their jobs, losing their health care, is so incredibly audacious, so irresponsible. How much money do you make?
My salary is $1.1 million. I received stock compensation with a value of $8.5 million and last year an annual incentive payment of $73,000.
Well, of course, it makes sense then that you would need a big rate increase.
Do you think you're finally going to get to the point where basically you're killing the goose that laid the golden egg? No one's going to be able to afford you?
You know, it is really an issue that we have got to get to the underlying cost of care, because we want access to health care. There are wonderful advances, wonderful technologies, and we want to make sure that we continue to have access.
Correct.
And that our customers continue to have access. And it needs to be affordable. And so we have to think about how.
But do you believe there's going to be a point where we can no longer afford it?
I think we as human beings greatly value our access to health care, which is why we continue.
I agree, and every family has to make a value judgment. Can I afford it today or not? So when my rates go up 39%, as our first panel said, we look at it, and pretty soon it's going to be, can I afford it anymore, or do I just drop it and hope I don't get sick?
Which is why we are in the market saying we have to get to reducing healthcare costs, making sure that people aren't getting unnecessary procedures or redundant procedures. We play that important role in healthcare. To eliminate us from the process eliminates the opportunity to get to that value equation.
And you're getting to the point where no one can afford it.
And we are serving 34 million Americans across the country, and our goal and desire is to try to get to for them affordable health benefits that they can continue to access the quality care, the drugs that they need and want.
And it's not working.
Well.
When I came to Congress, like our first panel, small business people, 64% of people had health insurance, would buy it. Now we're down to about 34%. That's why we have to do something on health care in this country, because the cost is killing us.
Sure enough, last year, with millions of people out of work and our economy in a tailspin, the country's five largest health insurers increased their profits by 56% to over $12 billion. So if President Obama and Congress finally agree on health care reform, does it get us any closer to solving problems like this? Who really wins, the health insurance industry or the rest of us? That's one reason why I invited Wendell Potter back to the Journal. Our conversation with him last summer resonated far and wide because he had just gone public.
What we have today, Mr. Chairman, is Wall Street-run health care.
Testifying before Congress about an industry in which he once had thrived as head of corporate communications for Cigna, the country's fourth largest health insurance company. Wendell Potter was an insider, an industry executive who'd fought long and hard against health care reform until one day in 2007 when he came upon a rural free clinic in West Virginia.
What I saw were doctors who were set up to provide care in animal stalls, or they'd erected tents to care for people. I mean, there was no privacy. In some cases, and I've got some pictures of people being treated on gurneys on rain-soaked pavement. And I saw people lined up, standing in line or sitting in these long, long lines, waiting to get care. It was absolutely stunning. It's like being hit by lightning. It's almost, what country am I in? It just didn't seem to be a possibility that I was in the United States.
Wendell Potter returned from that experience a changed man. He quit his job at Cigna, became a senior fellow at the Center for Media and Democracy, and ever since has been one of the country's leading champions of health care reform. Wendell Potter, welcome back.
Thank you for the opportunity, Bill.
You have as much knowledge as anybody I know about how these insurance companies work. So tell me, what on earth was WellPoint thinking when it jacked up its premiums by nearly 40% just as this healthcare debate was coming to a head.
Well, these companies are for-profit companies, and they think first and foremost about their shareholders. That's the first stakeholder that they consider. And they know that they have to meet those expectations or their stock prices will suffer. She, Angela Brawley, mentioned that she has stock options. So she has the incentive for that stock price to keep going up, because the more it goes up, the more she makes. So that's number one. They're looking after the best interest of the shareholders first, not the best interest of their customers.
But to increase premiums by double digits in 11 states seems to me a pretty stupid thing to do if you're trying to win friends and influence members of Congress.
You'd think so, but they spend so much money on lobbyists, on other ways to influence votes in Congress. They've invested many millions of dollars, all of these companies have, over the course of many months and many years to influence their votes
and
heading into this.
The Chamber of Commerce and others says they're going to spend a lot more money in the next month before all of this comes to a head.
And they will, and a lot of that money will come from the insurance companies, from your premiums and mine, that will go into the insurance companies, and they in turn will funnel money into the U.S. Chamber of Commerce and some of their other allies, and also into front groups to try to kill this bill before it ever reaches the president.
So are you suggesting that they could go ahead and do this really startling increase in premiums because they know they've got a grip on Congress through their contributions?
They do this because they know they can, and they're willing to sacrifice or they're willing to take whatever lumps they might take in the public and before Congress. And you can rest assured that she was well prepared before she went before Congress.
She's not alone, by the way. Look at this list of the total compensation for the top 10 healthcare CEOs in 2008. Aetna, $24 million. Cigna, your old company, $12 million. WellPoint, $9 million. That's her. Coventry Health, $9 million. Centene, $8 million. Amerigroup, $5 million. Humana, $4 million. HealthNet, $4 million. Universal American, $3 million. United Health Group compensation, $3 million. Their profits come from the difference between what we pay in premiums and what they pay for our health care, right?
That's
so
right.
They have this incentive you talk about to deny health care as often as possible.
Oh, absolutely. And they deny health care. And the reason why we have so many people who are uninsured and a growing number of people who are underinsured is precisely because of that. They are actually running business away. They want to get rid of unprofitable customers. They've been doing that for a long time, and Congress is just now catching on to that. One of the reasons why they've had to jack up the rates so much in the individual market to make money is that they have put more people into that market by running off small businesses, for example. They're purging small businesses.
You know, I noticed in the story at the middle of this week that these rate increases are aimed at individuals right. who can't get coverage right. through the workplace. They have to buy it on their own as individuals right. and at small businesses yeah. Up to 50 employees. I mean, they have to know, as the congressman said, that a lot of people cannot afford health insurance. So what do they expect to happen?
Well, they don't care, number one, that a lot of people can't afford insurance. It's highly unlikely that those CEOs that you mentioned have spent much time talking to people who really are in dire straits, who've lost their insurance or have been denied coverage. I was in that boat. It was a revelation to me to come face to face with a lot of those people. And most of those CEOs take great care to be able to make sure that they're not in that kind of a position.
Excuse my growing cynicism at this age and stage, but could this be the briar patch strategy? In other words, they want to get people angry enough for Congress to pass that health care reform with the mandate that delivers millions of new customers to them or under penalty of law.
Well, the way that the legislation is structured, this will give them a lot of new business and millions and millions, billions of dollars in new revenue, and much of it coming from taxpayers in the form of subsidies. Over 10 years, about $500 billion will come from the U.S. government to help cover the premiums of people who otherwise couldn't afford to pay those premiums. They will win, there's no doubt. They don't like a lot of this legislation. There's much they're trying to kill, and they could live without this bill being passed.
Well, they're doing pretty well, as it
oh,
is.
Oh, absolutely.
Personally, and individually.
Yeah, exactly. And this system can be sustained quite a long time, and they can get richer and richer as we get more and more underinsured and uninsured.
But let me show you something the president said in his speech on Wednesday. I want to know what you think about it.
Many, probably most, Republicans in Congress just have a fundamental disagreement over whether we should have more or less oversight of insurance companies. And if they truly believe that less regulation would lead to higher quality, more affordable health insurance, then they should vote against the proposal I've put forward.
Is the president essentially saying that the gist of this bill is oversight of the insurance industry?
Much of it is. There is a lot of new oversight of the insurance industry that this legislation would bring. At the federal level, there has not been anywhere close to adequate oversight of the insurance industry at either the federal or state level. And most of the regulation occurs at the state level, and it varies from state to state. What we've seen is regulation can work, but it can only work if the insurance departments have adequate resources and if they understand the importance of regulation. And there needs to be a federal component because a lot of states don't do it adequately. It has been deregulated, or there has been deregulation in a lot of states. And we have seen these price increases go up. And in a lot of states, the insurance coverage is woefully inadequate because there aren't many customer protections in many states.
No one knows right now what the compromise final legislation will look like. The Senate bill, the House bill, President Obama's own version that is now in play. But of all that's being discussed and of the likely compromise, what do you like about it? What's good about the most promising compromise?
Well, first of all, going forward, insurance companies cannot deny us coverage. They'll have to insure us. So many of us are born with pre-existing conditions, and are not able to buy insurance at any price. That will end. And that automatically will make sure that a lot of people who are uninsured can get coverage. It will end some of these egregious practices like rescissions, which is a practice of companies going back and canceling your insurance when you start, when you get sick or injured. That happens all the time. That will become unlawful. A lot of these practices of these insurance companies will be made illegal, as they should have been a long time ago.
Do you see anything in this debate, in the provisions that are being debated in Congress right now, that would cut $1 of corporate profits?
I do. I think that, first of all, if you can end the practice of they're using pre-existing conditions to deny coverage, that's a big, big thing.
Why?
It's a big thing because that is one of the ways that they cut people out of being covered. If they're forced to take all comers, even people who really need insurance, which is what we're hoping to accomplish with this legislation, that means that they'll have to spend money covering the care that they need. And that's another reason why you have this mandate of trying to make sure that everyone does get in the system, because you have to have everyone in the system before that works.
But at the same time, they're getting, as you say, this mandate which delivers them millions of new customers. So in effect, is it a wash? I mean, they're having to spend more money if this legislation passes, but they get more income from the mandated coverage.
They do that. But I think we need to look at this as a win for consumers as well. Yes, it'll be a win for the insurance companies, but I don't think we want to wind up with the insurance companies walking away winning the whole ball game. If we don't do anything right now, that's what will happen. They'll win everything.
So pre-existing condition is one reason that you like this? Do you think there might be something good coming out of this?
Oh, absolutely.
What's another one?
Increased regulation, as we talked about. And also, this will, if the president's proposals go through, there will be more regulation at the federal level. There will be more effective review of these rates. And the Secretary of Health, of HHS will be able to determine if those rate increases are appropriate or not.
Before they're made?
Before
they're
made.
Not after the fact. Now, many states are going to be made after, has the review after the fact?
Yeah.
So what else?
And it will also limit the amount of money that people pay out of their own pockets for care. And this is extremely important because one of the ways that these companies are continuing to make more and more money every year is shifting the cost of care from them and from employers to us. One of the women before Congress was talking about her out-of-pocket expenses being in the thousands, maybe $9,000. Well, Anthem in Ohio got approval to offer a product, a health plan with a $20,000 deductible. That's the future. If we don't have reform that makes stuff like that illegal, we're all going to be in the ranks of the underinsured pretty soon.
So I hear Wendell Potter saying that if he were in the Senate or the House, he would vote for this reform?
I would vote for it. I was distraught when I saw what happened, what I saw the Senate voting on, but then I realized, I've studied a lot of these efforts over the past many years to get reform, And often we've come short because we've tried to get the perfect, and we've never been able to get anything as a consequence. So I fear that we may
be. Not since Medicare, right?
Not since Medicare.
But I remember, Wendell, I remember President Johnson saying, well, let's get this bill. It's a flawed bill, 1965 passed, and other Congresses and presidents will come along and improve it over the next several years. That never happened.
But there have been some improvements. People who are on dialysis, for example, they can, you know, they now qualify for the Medicare program. That's an improvement. People with disabilities are eligible for Medicare. So it can change, and who knows, maybe in years to come, there can be other substantial changes to Medicare and Medicaid that will be beneficial to all of us. But yes, this is important. We need to have a foundation, and this may seem to be not an adequate foundation for a lot of people, but there are more than 50 million people in this country who don't have insurance. I don't want to go back and tell them, I'm sorry, we just couldn't get a good enough bill. So you're going to have to wait to who knows when. Maybe you won't live long enough. 45,000 people, Bill, die every year because they don't have health insurance coverage. And that's recent. In years to come, that will increase. People can't wait any longer.
Do you see any of the proposals being debated on the Hill reversing the perverse incentives that lead doctors to overtreat the well-insured?
There are not as many controls in this legislation as I think that there could be, but I think that there are some, and doctors do have an incentive in many cases to overprescribe and overtreat, and there are provisions in this bill that address that.
Do you think there are enough provisions that will contain the soaring cost?
I think it's a beginning. I think you will see that. The private market has lost its ability to control these costs. So the federal government has to step in and play some role. And I think that we'll begin to see that with this legislation.
So you're saying what others have been saying, that doing nothing is not an option?
It's not an option. The free market does not work in healthcare like it does in other sectors of the economy. In fact, it works just the opposite. And what's happening is that competition is driving up costs. It's not controlling costs, it's driving them up. It doesn't work like other sectors of the economy. The hospitals and the doctors, now that they are bigger and more powerful and have more bargaining clout, can get more at the bargaining table in terms of increases in what the insurance companies pay them. So that's why costs keep going up. The insurance companies have lost the ability to control cost, and the way they're continuing to make money is to shift more and more of the cost to us through these high deductible plans that they're marketing.
So Senator Potter votes for it. It passes. The president signs it. Now you're facing an opponent in this upcoming November election. Your opponent runs ads saying, Senator Potter voted for a massive government takeover of health care. Senator Potter voted to put bureaucrats in between you and your doctor. So you get him bombarded with all of these ads. How do you respond?
Well, I would, by facts, for number one, but also by one of the things that I think advocates of reform have not done is to understand how the opponents play the political game. And they've been talking about this being a government takeover of the healthcare system for a long time. They've been engaging in fear-mongering even before the first bill was introduced in either the House or the Senate. They knew what was coming, and then their strategy was to try to manipulate public opinion. So the incumbents, the Democrats, are going to have to go back to the reasons why we're having this debate in the first place and to say, look, what would happen if we didn't do anything? Here's what would have happened to you. You cannot rest assured that you're going to be able to keep your insurance if you lose your job. You probably already know somebody who's lost their job and their coverage. It might be you might be someone in your own family. Think about your own children. Think about what could have happened if we didn't act. This might be the most important thing that any member of Congress right now will vote on. And I would certainly want to make sure that I've voted the right way.
So let's go back to your unrepentant days when you were in the war room of the health insurance industry, and you were trying to figure out PR strategies to advance the interest of your company and the industry. What would you be advising right now?
I'd be advising that a lot of the money that they have available to them for PR and advertising be funneled into organizations like the U.S. Chamber of Commerce, the National Federation of Independent Business, and other groups that are their natural allies and have been for many years, to advertise all across the country, and in particular in states and districts where there might be some vulnerable members of Congress, to call this government takeover, to try to continue to scare people. You will see that, to scare people away from this. and at the same time try to say that we are in favor of reform. We just need to have a bipartisan approach to reform. Those are words that sound good. So continue
Why?
With this duplicitous campaign. Why? Because people
Why do they put bipartisan on it when the Republicans haven't yielded an inch?
Because they know that the public likes the idea of bipartisanship, and the public doesn't realize that the realities in Washington are making bipartisanship virtually impossible, at least on this issue and on many other issues. It's not achievable.
So, Wendell, you reluctantly are going to support this bill.
I would.
What don't you like about it?
I don't like the fact that it doesn't include the public option. That was so much a part of the House bill, even though it was watered down. It was a good thing to have included, and I regret that. And I hope that maybe in future years Congress can revisit that. And I think they will if they're seeing that the reform doesn't work as envisioned.
So you would say yes and then fight again for another day to make it better?
I would vote for it. Is it the be-all and end-all? No, it's not. There are other things that I think will have to come back in years to come. But wouldn't you rather, and I think wouldn't most Americans rather, that we have something to start from rather than starting from scratch the next time? It's very hard to build up to doing this in the first place. And keep in mind that the special interests have almost an unlimited amount of money to spend to influence the results. I'm frankly pretty amazed that we're getting this close to passing something.
Wendell Potter, it's been good to see you again.
Thank you very much, Bill.